Good morning, everybody. Once again, I would like to welcome you all for second class on module 3 of microcontroller. In the previous class, we have discussed about brief introduction to stack. What is meant by stack, right? So we have discussed the learning outcomes. Briefly, we have gone through the instruction set of 8051. Right, all the instructions, as we have seen, that are categorized into arithmetic instructions, logical instructions, data transfer instructions, boolean variable instructions, and then program branching instructions. Right. So this briefly we have gone through in the previous class, and also we have started our discussion on the stack pointer. Right. So there are two important instructions which are associated with the stack. Those two instructions are known as push and then pop instructions, right? So exactly the push and pop operations will work opposite to each other, whereas a push instruction is basically used to store the information on the stack, and then after that stack pointer will be incremented by one. Whereas in pop instruction, the data will be copied, will be retrieved, and then stack pointer will be decremented by once. And so this figure basically explains us the operation of push and pop. And also we have tried to understood the concept of push and pop using these examples. Right. Now coming to the instruction push and then the pop, right? So if you are looking at the slide, push instruction, this instruction basically increments the stack pointer by one. The content of direct, which is an internal memory location, or a SFR, which is special function register, are copied into internal RAM location addressed by the stack pointer, right? So we have discussed that the default stack address is 07. So the execution of these push and pop instructions will not affect any flags. So in the red, we have mentioned that no flags are affected. So examples you can take as push 22H and then push 23H, right? So basically the stack pointer points to memory location 4FH, and the content of memory locations 22H and 23H are 11 and 12H respectively, right? So after the above instruction, the stack pointer is 51H, and the internal RAM location 50H and 51 will store 11 and 12 respectively. So this is the operation of the push operation. Whereas in case of pop instruction, right? Again, pop direct. So this instruction reads the content of the internal RAM location addressed by the stack pointer and decrement the stack pointer by one. So you can see that it is exactly opposite to that of push. The data read is then transferred the direct address, which is an internal memory or a special function register. Again, as in case of push, in pop also no flags are affected. So example, you can look at the slides. So pop DPH and pop DPL. Again, this DPH and DPL is a 16-bit data pointer register. So if the stack pointer is 51H originally, and internal RAM location is 44F and 50H, and 51 contain the values of 30H, 11H and 12H respectively, the instructions above leave stack pointer with 4FH and DPTR with 1211H. Again, one more example is what pop stack pointer SP. If the above line of instruction follows, then SP is equal to 30H. In this case, stack pointer is decremented to 4EH before being loaded with the value that is pop, that is 30H. Now coming to the subroutines, right? Basically, subroutines are the small programs, right, which appear repeatedly in a program, right, instead of writing those same set of instructions many times. So we can write those same lines as in subroutine, and whenever it is required, we can call the subroutine. So basically, subroutines are handled by call and then the return instructions, right? So whenever we want to utilize the some set of instructions, right? So we can execute those instructions by an instruction known as what, call instruction, and then once those instructions are executed, we can return to the main program. So there are types of call instructions, right? One of them is being L call address. Here L stands for long call, the 16 bit. This is a long call instructions which unconditionally call the subroutine located at the indicated address. So the 16 bit address, this is a 3 byte instruction. The long call instructions will work as explained below. So during the execution of L call, that the PC will become PC plus 3, right, because it is a 3 byte instruction. So during the execution of this instruction, 3 to 5H plus 3H, then the address becomes 3 to 57H. So the stack pointer will become a stack pointer plus 1. It is increments, right? So if SP contains default value 07, then once this instruction is executed, the stack pointer becomes 08. Then stack pointer is equal to a PC720, that is lower byte of a PC content, that is 57 will be stored in memory location 08, and then again stack pointer will be incremented once again. So from 08 it now goes to 09. Then stack pointer is what, PC1528, that is higher byte of PC content, that is 32 will be stored in memory location 09. So basically 08 and 09 memory location will have the data of 57 and then 32 respectively. So with these address, right, which was in PC, is stored in the stack. So program counter is equal to 16 bit address. The new address of subroutine is loaded to PC. Again, in the call instructions, no flags are affected. Right. There is one more call which is known as what, absolute call. This is an absolute call instruction which unconditionally calls the subroutine located at the indicated location. It is 11 bit address. So this is a 2 byte instructions, and the A call instructions will work as follows. So during the execution of A call, right, PC is equal to PC plus 2 because it is a 2 byte instructions. Right. Please remember that in case of L call, PC is equal to PC plus 3, right? So if the address L call resides in location 8549, right? So during the execution of this instruction, PC is equal to 8549 plus 2, because you can see that for execution of L call, PC will become PC plus 2. So presently we have a PC value of 8549. So to that 2 will be added because it is a 2 byte instruction. So it becomes 8549BH. So stack pointer will become SP plus 1. Again, default value, assuming that stack pointer has got a default value of 07, then stack pointer increments and it becomes 08. So in the stack pointer, the lower byte of PC address, that is 4B, will be stored in the memory location 08. Again, stack pointer will be incremented. So from 08, now it moves to 09. So the higher byte of PC will be stored, that is, in this case, 85, will be stored in the memory location 09. So the difference between the long call and then the absolute call is what? In case of absolute call, it is PC is equal to PC plus 2 during execution, whereas in case of long call, PC becomes a PC plus 3. And then lower byte will be stored in the location 08, and higher byte will be stored in the next location, right? 08 and 09 in this case, assuming that stack pointer have a default value of 07. Right, then L call address 16. This instruction calls a subroutine located at the indicated address. Right, the operation will cause the PC to increase by 3. Then it pushes the 16 bit PC value onto the stack and increment the stack pointer twice. And the PC then loaded with the value address 16 and program execution continues from the new location. Since it is a long call, the subroutine may therefore begin anywhere in the full 64 kilobyte program memory address space. No flags are affected in this case, as we have already discussed. So example is shown here, a long call with a address as LOC underscore SUB. So initially default value is 07, a stack pointer is 07, and then the label LOC underscore sub is at a program memory location, say 2034H. So executing the instruction at location 023H. So SP is 09, internal RAM locations 08 and 09 contains 33 and 02 respectively, and program counter has got 2034. Then absolute call with an address of 16. So as we know that in this case, program counter will increase by only 2. So in this case, the subroutine must start within the same 2 kilobyte block of program memory. Whereas in case of long call, it is anywhere in the 64 kilobyte. Whereas in case of absolute call, it is only 2 kilobyte. So example of absolute call is given here. So again, if stack pointer has got a default value of 07 and label LOC underscore sub is at program memory location 0567H, then executing the instruction at location 0230H. So SP is 09 because SP will be incremented by twice. Internal RAM location 08 and 09 will consist of 32 and 02 respectively, and program counter has got 0567H. So one more instructions we need to discuss is return. That again, please keep in mind that this instruction is used along with the call instructions, whether it is absolute call or long call, to return from the subroutine to the main program. So this instructions returns the program from a subroutine. RET pop the high byte and low byte of address of PC from the stack and decrement the stack pointer by 2. Again, we can visualize this as something similar to pop operation. The execution of the instruction will result in the program to resume from the location just left, just after the call instructions. Again, in this case, no flags are affected. So you can visualize that we have a program, main program, wherein we need to use a call instruction, whether it is absolute call or long call. So before going to the subroutine, all the information will be stored on the stack, all the important informations. And once that subroutine is executed, we need to come back to the main program. So that we can be doing with the help of a RET instruction. So once it comes back to the main program, right? So it will retrieve all the information which are stored at the stack. So suppose in this case, stack pointer is 0BH originally and internal RAM locations are 0 and 0B contains the value of 30 and 02 respectively that we have stored whenever we need to give the service for the call instructions. So the instruction leaves SP is equal to 09 and program execution will continue at a location 023H. Right, with these brief information, let us try to write the program, right, using assembly language program. So that program is what? Write a program in 8051 to transfer 10 bytes of data from location starting with an address 30H to a location starting with 2000H without overlap, right? So for writing this program, we must know the instruction set of 8051, right? So basically in this program, what we need to do is we have a 10 bytes of data. Let us assume that the data is 11 to AA, right? Random data we have taken. So memory 30H has got a data of 11, 31 has got a data of 22 and so on. So total data, that is from 30 to 39, these are the memory locations. So 30 to 39 memory location has got a data of 11 to AA. So what we need to do in this program is we need to transfer the data 11, which is there in 30H, to a other memory location. Say in this case, it is 2000H. So you can see from the table, the 11 data which is there at a memory location 30H is transferred to a memory location 2000 and then so on. So the data which is there in at 31, which is 22 in this case, is transferred to memory location 2001 and then so on. So for this, we need to write a program. Let us have a look at the program, right? So first and foremost, we need to initialize the two memory locations, that is in this case 30H and then 2000H. And then also we need to initialize the how many number of bytes of data we need to transfer. In this case, the 10, count is 10. So you can see that move R0 comma hash of 30H. In this case, the 30H is the starting memory location where we have the 10 data which are needs to be transferred to 2000H. Right, and then next in second you can see that move a comma hash of 00H. So what we are trying to do here is we are clearing the accumulator, right? Yeah, because accumulator may consist of some other default value. Then move r7 comma hash of 10H. So here 10H is the count, number of data which are to be transferred. In this case, it is 10. Then move dptr comma hash of 0200H. This is the external address to which we want to transfer. Right. So once we are done with this, right, now we need to take the first data from memory 30 into some register, and then we need to transfer the data which is there in that register to memory location. Right. So you can see that move a comma at the rate of R0, it is indirect addressing mode. So R0 is basically pointing to a memory location 30H. That 30H has got the initial data of 11. So 11 will be copied into accumulator A. So once that instruction is executed, now A consists of 11, right? And then move X at the rate dptr comma a. So dptr is pointing to a memory address 200. To that address we need to transfer. So now a has got 11. That 11 will be transferred to 200. So once this instruction is executed, right, we have achieved of transferring a data 11, which is there in 30H, to a memory location mentioned by 0200H, right? So we have transferred one data from 30H to 200H. Similarly, we have total 10 data bytes which are needs to be transferred. So out of 10, one we have transferred. So now we can use the loop instructions, right? So increment R0. Initially R0 is now at 30. Once we increment that, now R0 becomes 31. And that is next memory location. Similarly, we need to increment the data pointer. Now it is pointing to 0200. If you increment it, now it becomes 0201. That is next memory location. And then we need to repeat the same operation, right? So DJ, NJ, DJ, decrement, jump on non-zero, R7 to back. So now R7 is 10. It will be decremented by once. No, so now it becomes 09. Right, and it is not equal to 0, so it will go back to this location again. R0 data will be copied into here. Now R0 is pointing to 31. 31 has got a data of 22. That will be transferred to accumulator. And then from accumulator to DPTR. Now DPTR is pointing to 201. So this program will continue until R7 becomes 0. So once R7 becomes 0, this instruction decrement, let us assume that now R7 is 01. Decrement it, it becomes 0, right? So decrement jump on non-zero. But now R7 becomes 0, so it will not go to this allocation. It comes to the last instruction, which is end. So once this program is executed, this loop is executed 10 times, the counter becomes 0, then it is the end of the program. And you can check the location 200. There is a slight mistake here. Right here, memory location we have mentioned as 2000 hex, whereas in the program it is it has only 200. So you can make this as in 2000 hex, or we can make this as only 200. So you can check the memory location once the program is executed, and you can find out that all the data which are there from 30 to 39. Are transferred to a memory location from 2002-2009. This is a program without overlapping. So as the memory locations are different, right? These are one memory location is from 30 to 39, the other memory location is from 2002-2009. So there is no question of overlapping here, right? There are programs wherein we need to write the same program with a overlap. So with a overlap means what? The same memory location we are using. That is one more program wherein we need to count the number of ones and zeros in a given 8-bit data. So write a program in 8051 to count the number of ones and zeros in a 8-bit data. Right. So before getting into the programming part, so first we should know the functioning of the rotate instruction and then the shift instructions, right? So when a 8-bit data is given to us, right, and if you represent that 8-bit data in binary, we have number of ones and zeros, right? So our task is to calculate the count and number of ones and number of zeros we have in that 8-bit data. So for this, we need to use the rotate instructions. Either you can use rotate right or rotate left, right? So before using rotate right and rotate left, right, let us quickly revise the function of RRCA, which is rotate right with a carry. So move a comma hash of 09, 0A9. So here A9 is the 8-bit data. So A9 we can represent in binary as A as 1010 and 9 as 1001, right? And then what you can do is you can rotate that either towards right or towards left. There will not be any difference in writing the program. Either you can use rotate right or rotate left. So moment you rotate it, right, so the LSB will comes to the carry, right? And we need to look at the content of this carry. If it is one, if a carry is generated, then we know that it is bit one. If there is no carry generated, then it is as a bit zero, and then you can count it, right? So in this case, we need the three counters. One counter for the 8-bit data, one counter for counting number of ones, and then the third counter is for counting number of zeros, right? So you can see that move DPTR comma hash of 6000 H. This is the address where we have a data of which we want to count number of ones and zeros, right? So then move XA comma at the rate of DPTR. So that data is copied into A. And then you can look at the instruction move R0 comma hash of 08, because we have 8 bits in a byte. So accumulator has got some data, and that data can be represented using 8 bits. So this is the first counter, and we need to rotate. We need to rotate 8 times, right? And then you can see the two more instructions: move R2 comma hash of 0, move R3 comma hash of 0. These two are the counters for counting number of zeros and number of ones. And then clear C, right? Clear carry flag, because prior to this program, in the execution of previous program, the carry flag may be set, right? So if you're not clearing it, our result may be wrong. So on the safer side, as we don't know whether carry is set or reset in the previous execution, so it is better to make clear the carry flag, right? So then rotate left with a carry, right? So rotate left with a carry means what? The MSB will come out and it goes to the carry, and then use the instruction jump on carry next, right? Jump on carry next means what? The MSB is out and we are checking that MSB bit, and if it is one, that means there is a carry. So jump on carry to next means what? There is a one. Next is what? Increment R3. So here R3 is basically used to count number of ones. So if there is no carry is set, then what we are doing is we are incrementing R2. That means R2 here is used to count number of zeros. So we need to keep in mind that increment R2, we need to jump to next to 2. Right. So then we use a short jump to next 2, and then whether it is 1 or 0, that will be stored in R3 or R2. Then decrement the count, first count, which is 0, 8. So decrement jump on non-zero R2, sorry, R0. So this loop will continue until R0 becomes 0. So now it goes to this, again we'll be using RLC. Again, the second bit will come out. Again, we are checking whether it is 1 or 0, and accordingly, the counters are incremented. So this will continue until R0 becomes 0. So once the program is executed, the content of R2 will tell us the number of zeros in a data byte, and the content of R3 will tell us the number of ones in a given data byte, right? So as we have discussed in this program, we are using RLC. As we have discussed, instead of RLC, you can use RRC also, and it is always better to write the same program with different instructions, with a different logic. And I advise the students to look for the alternative to write the program. Okay, in the next class, we'll discuss some more programs